talking a little bit about our one of our game jams we do. If you're not familiar with the game jam, it's a 48-hour jam to make an entire video game on weekend. And so this is just one of the ones we do. We do it twice a year on our campus, and it's a really great event. It's a lot of fun. Not a lot of sleep, for sure. And people are pretty smelly about it, but it's a great time. A great way to learn about game making and interface with a lot of game people and learn a lot.
Film it one more time. I made him rush, so. Yeah, grab these two rows and grab these wings over here. All right, I think we got everyone now. Franklin?
Thanks, sir. All right. Hey, everybody, how are you? Super amped, right? What else could it be, right? You're here. That's what it's all about. My name is Dr. Franklin. I'm really glad to meet you guys. I am at Kennesaw State University. I work on the Marietta campus. We call it the Nerd Campus. It's where all the little nerds are. It's like a little nerd zoo. It's so fun. College of Engineering is there, College of Computing is there, a number of others. But it's Marietta campus is just about 9 miles south of here. And it's an awesome place to be, super creative, lots of folks that are just really into gaming. We have gaming communities there that people live in gaming housing, and they just focus on gaming all the time. We obviously have a game design degree, game design development, four-year bachelor degree. One of the first, it was the first in the world, but it was one of the only that's a fully accredited, ABET accredited degree. So really, really, really cool. How many of you are interested in making gaming your career, part of your career? Nice. So is it, are you thinking about being a professional gamer? Professional gamer? Maybe? Yeah, do that. Yeah, you can certainly get a scholarship for it now, right? A lot of esports stuff going on. Making games, being a game developer. Yeah, game developer? Good. So we're gonna talk a little bit about that today, some of the tools that you can use and kind of the idea, my theme for my talk is to say this. I want you to start making games right now. Don't wait until you're in college. Don't wait until you finish your degree. Don't wait. Start doing it right now. There is no reason you can't completely pay for your college degree by making video games that you sell on the internet. Right? No need. Even if all it does is buy you some pizza, only thing better than pizza is free pizza, right? You know what I'm saying? Right? But it's just start now. That's thematically what I'm going to tell you. You don't have to wait. Right? You don't have to wait until you learn something or you're doing something in the future. There's nothing in the way of you making the next greatest video game. Right? And a lot of games that you know that are world famous that make billions of dollars, they had no idea they were going to be any good when they were making them. Right? They just caught on. They're viral. Right? It's crazy what goes on with those kinds of games. Right? Fortnite isn't even the game that they were making. Fortnite is actually a demo of a game they were going to make, and people love the demo so much it became an overnight sensation, right? People love playing it. And it's an incredible game, and it's been in beta for 7 years worth of effort. It's ridiculous, right? Because it wasn't even the game they were trying to make. It was just like a demo of it. A lot of people have played CSGO, Counter-Strike kind of games. Counter-Strike was a demo for the Half-Life game when it was coming out, and they just made this like as a way to test the multiplayer. It turns out that Counter-Strike became its own franchise inside of that, right? So lightning can strike anywhere. It's not limited to Hollywood budgets and million-dollar budgets and that kind of thing. It can be right there in your garage, right there in your basement. You can absolutely make the next internet game of this century, right? Make plenty of money. Imagine how cool that would be. Not only put yourself through college, but you buy your parents their house, right? That would be kind of a fun thing to be able to do, right? It's just cool stuff. On behalf of all parents everywhere, yes, do it. So that's what I'm talking to you about. Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. Right? Arthur C. Clarke, well-known quote. The idea is that if you traveled back in time and you showed someone a cell phone, right? They would probably burn you at a stake, right? They're like, you're a witch, right? It's witchcraft, demons, right? How are you doing this, right? I've been to places in the world that they've never seen pictures, right? And we would take digital pictures, like take a picture of someone and show them a picture, and they've never, other than reflections in water, they've never seen a picture of themselves. And there are cultures where they think that you've kidnapped them, you've captured their soul, so you can't take pictures, right? It's a very interesting cultural thing. Any sufficiently advanced technology feels like magic. Video games may feel like there's a magic there, but it's really just technology, right? And not only is it technology, it's accessible technology. There's nothing that a AAA studio has that you don't have right at your disposal, right? It's just technology. So that means it's something we can learn. Yeah, you've got to apply yourself. Yes, you have to do some homework. Yeah, you've got to put some blood, sweat, and tears in it. Yes, but you can get there. It doesn't actually require magic, right? If I want to be the greatest football player ever, that requires a lot of things, determination, hard work, and some natural talent, right? I can't always manufacture that, but something like this, with technology, it means you can, in fact, conquer it, right? It's really great stuff. So why do people get involved with gaming? Well, a lot of people realize that it's because there's so many different aspects. If you've been well trained by Marvel, now you stay through the credits at the movies when you go watch the movies, right? And you realize there's a lot of names that go by on the screen. And you think, how can you meet all those people? Because you think it's only the seven people that you see on camera that made the movie, right? And they're actually the people that spend the least number of hours working on that movie. Right? There are people that spend 8 hours setting up the lighting for the shot that actor came in and was there for 38 seconds and left. Right? Entire people who build sets, who build the costume that they wear, they're super elaborate. Or that spend, 9 months making Superman's mustache disappear. Right? Whatever you might end up having to do. Right? These things happen in the real world. Right? There's a lot of people that go into it. And I just want you to understand that there's a lot of that. If you want to be involved in a super big studio, then your job will be very, 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 very specific. If you work at a medium-sized studio, you'll have a wider responsibility. If you work at an indie studio, you'll have extremely wide latitude. And so if you're the kind of person who says, I want to do a little bit of everything in the game-making process, then you should be at a smaller studio. If you're like, nope, I want to be a 3D sound engineer, then great, work at a huge studio, right? But you should learn something about yourself, what it is that you want to do. Little quick caveat, I do work for KSU, and I'm happy to talk to you about KSU. More than happy to share that, but that is not at all why I'm here. In fact, I'm not even going to recommend you come to my college of all the colleges out there. What I am going to tell you is the faster you learn about what you want to do for your life, the better your college decision will be. And if you know exactly what you want to do for college, you should find a college that's really good for that and go there. Whichever one it might be. Might be public, might be private, might be whatever, might be inner state, might be outer state. If you don't know what you want to do in college, then I highly recommend going somewhere like KSU or maybe a community college where they have a wide variety of really good programs and you can navigate that over the couple of years that you're going and kind of figure out what you want to do. Does that make some sense? But if you know, like, I want to be in nursing, then find a great nursing program and go to that school. If you want to do business, then find a great business school and go to that university. Right? I think KSU is a great university, or else I wouldn't work there. But I'm just trying to explain. I'm not here to try and get you to come to my university. Right? We're chock full of students. We're good. Right? But I would love for you to be there if it's the right one for you. Does that make sense? But I just want to give you general advice. The sooner you learn what it is you want to do and what your passion is, and I'll tell you this, if I could give you any free advice, it would be this. Pursuing money is super frustrating and very, very hollow. It will never bring you happiness. Right? If people are like, I'd love to try, I get it, but you wouldn't. Right? Find what you're passionate about and figure out how to make the most money you can at that. Does that make sense? So it's okay that you want to make good money at what you do, that's fantastic, but make sure it's something you're passionate about, something when you wake up, you have a reason to go to that job, right? Something you really love, something that really is warm, that you're excited about. When you wake up, you're like, yeah, let's do it, right? That's way better than having a job where you make a bunch of money, but every day of your life is miserable. Does that make sense? So just thinking about careers, you know, why get involved with gaming? That's the question on the screen here. There are a lot of different reasons. Maybe you're into graphics. Maybe you're an artist. You want to do 3D animation. You want to build characters. You want to build worlds, right? That's a great way to do it. Maybe you're all about human beings, right? I want to talk about human-computer interaction or user-centered design, right? I usually use the example of the Xbox controller. That Xbox controller is the work, the product of thousands of hours of research, right? Everyone hold up your left hand for me real quickly. Spread your fingers out for me. Look around the room and look at all the different hands. How could we possibly design a controller that could fit all of those different hands, right? It's not easy, right? Thinking about how that works. Because if the controller doesn't work, right? Like, my kids love for me to play the Switch with them, which is kind of fun, except the Switch is like not for pause, right? It's like, ah. So every once in a while, when I can wrestle it out of one of my kids' hands, I'll use the Pro Controller. That feels a little bit more lifelike for me. But they love to watch it because I'll be getting into some really good Super Smash, and then the controller just goes flying. Like, it's so small, right? It's just like, oh, but it's portable. It's like, yeah, but my hands aren't portable. I don't know what to tell you, right? But, you know, it's that human-computer interaction. What works for people? How do I make it appeal to you, right? How do I make it interesting, right? How do I help you find your voice in this kind of thing? How do I make sure that interface works? Some people are really into networking. You like to think about these massively multiplayer online games. How do I get 3,000 people to play my game all at the same time? How do I build a virtual world that's so big that I can make this happen and invite people into this world space with me? How do I do that? It is not trivial, right? It is a massively complicated technological problem to try to get all those users from all those different internet services, all those different quality of internet to play a game where someone doesn't win just because they have the fastest internet, right? It's hard. It sounds easy, but it's not. Right? What happens if you lose internet connection? Does your character freeze? Right? Do you keep playing and you just die? What happens? I feel like we should have a pose that's like when you lose your connection, it like puts a shield around you and your avatar is just like, you know, like that, like leave me alone, right? That was always our, you know, when we did multiplayer, when we were away from the keyboard, we would go walk into a corner and put our head down in the corner and be like, dude, leave me alone. I'm clearly not playing right now. You know? Don't be that one guy who kills people in the corner. That's ridiculous, right? It's a hard problem, right? Maybe that's the part of it that gets you excited. Maybe what you really love is hardware, right? How many of you are Xbox console Xbox people? Xbox? PlayStation? Xbox and PlayStation? PC gamers? Right, there we go. That's not a problem. PC gaming will always be the best. Always. Wow. Now, misunderstand me. Just listen to the whole statement. It'll always be the best. It'll be the best because it's way, way, way more expensive. And it's much harder because you have to deal with drivers and configuration, and it's a nightmare to get all that stuff together. But when it's working, woof, it's the fastest, best graphics available anywhere, right? Consoles will always be easier, and they'll always be awesome because you just go boop and you're playing, right? So they're awesome, but they'll never be the best because they had to pick a model and be like, this is the hardware inside of here, and we're going to make this for 2 years, and it will never be the latest, greatest. PC users, yeah, you have the latest, greatest. Congratulations. Instead of paying $500, you paid $5,000. But you got the latest greatest, right? Look, I'm a PC gamer. I'm all about it. I'm just explaining to you I also own a bunch of consoles, because sometimes it's nice to hit a button and start playing. Right? Don't deal with upgrading or updating or anything. Yes?
A computer would actually be a better investment than a console, because you could play for the long period of time, but keep buying consoles again and again. And so the price of a console, the fee would be higher than
you
pay for a PC.
That's a good argument, right? It's a good investment. I don't know that that's the only reason it's a good investment, but it's a good investment for a variety of reasons. If you build your own computer, the act of building a computer is really great education. I think that's fantastic. It would take a long time of console upgrades to catch up to the price, but you're right. But a computer is a multi-use capable device. You can do your homework on it, you can write papers on it, you can do research on it, you can do a lot of things other than just play video games, right? That's a good point, right? And my point isn't which one is the greatest one. Obviously, PCs is the best, obviously. But doesn't mean I hate consoles. It's more important that you understand how do we make this work for everybody. What is the right hardware and architecture to make this thing work? What's really convenient? Why is the Switch popular? If what I just said was important, why would the Switch ever make it? It's not as powerful. It's not the most powerful console. It's certainly not as powerful as a PC. Why is it important? It's portable, right? And it turns out that portable is super important. There are people who love it. So at my house, we own all of the things, and we have all of them. And I will tell you, we probably log more hours on the Switch than anything else. Well, it's not true. When we do group PC gaming, we obviously log hundreds of hours. We were about 300 hours into Borderlands, I think. But we have a lot of those hours in there. But the Switch is the one they play the most, right? It's easy to grab 8 people and play right now, right? I mean, it's hard to find the 8 controllers that somehow live in the house, but if you have them, it's great. 8 people playing Smash, instantly, boom, Switch, done. right? Nice and easy. It's really popular, but it doesn't do any. It doesn't do either thing. It's not the most powerful console, and it's certainly not a PC. Yet it's popular because user interface design says portability matters. And I have had it where my kids are engaged in a game. We drag them out of the house to put them in a car to go out there in the what's that thing called? The sunny face thing, and the right? Go out there, and they just keep the game going. They just unplug and they just keep the game going, and we get where we're going, and they're like, go back. They don't even know where we went sometimes, right? They just kept playing. It's great. So maybe you're about hardware and architecture. Maybe you're like me, you're about artificial intelligence. So my PhD is in computer science, but my work is in artificial intelligence and robotics. That's what I do. And so yes, I'm building computers that can think like people, and I'm building machines that they can live inside of. So yes, I'm slowly but surely bringing about the end of mankind. Sorry about that. I apologize in advance. But I'm not worried about it. And please don't try and travel back in time and kill me. It won't work. People have already tried that. So it's not gonna happen. But this is my world as AI, right? This is what I do, embodiment of AI in robotics. And it's cool. But video game AI is really challenging, all right? So I have a question for you. I build AI for Department of Defense stuff. And when I do Department of Defense AI, its objective is to just win. Very simple. Don't let any missiles come to us. Don't let any bad guys across this line. Don't just win, right? Why would I say something like I'm about to say? I developed world-class AI, very difficult AI, but I need you to hear this. The hardest AI you could ever design is for video games. Why do you think that is? Okay, player enjoyment is important. Okay, so we might have a long discussion about the word random. I would argue, I don't have time for it, but I will never let you use the word random in my class. Nothing is random, but I do understand what you're saying. It is pseudo-random for sure, unpredictable, stochastic. Yes?
Because computers can react a lot faster than human
beings,
so you have to add that delay.
Right, so you have to add delay, you have to cheat, you have to anti-cheat, right? Kind of a weird thing. Yeah, so good ideas. So I use the analogy of when you're a dad and you have your little two-year-old and you do the race to the car game. You guys know this race to the car game? Like, I'll race you to the car, right? And so then the dad like takes off like, oh, I'm gonna win, and you're like way ahead of him. And you're like, oh, my knee, and they come zooming by you, and they're like, no, and you run, and then they go zooming by you, and you just make sure like they out-touch you by a millimeter, right? Because they love that, right? That's why gaming AI is really hard, because you have to almost win. If the AI I could build it and just be like dominate, that would be easy to build, right? It knows exactly where every player is and every object is on the board. It would never ever miss, and so you could never beat a game AI at its own game. And even if you could, it could do things like its bullet is firing and you're not in the right spot. It could just be like boop and move you into the front of the bullet, right? It owns everything. It's drawing all the pixels, right? It can make it work. You hit me. I hit you. No, you didn't. Yes, I did. Let me check the instant replay. Haha, I did, right? See, that's how it works. Game AI is really hard because it has to almost win. And almost win is a really tough algorithm. How do I make it challenging so that as my kids get older, now my 22-year-old, we don't do race to the car anymore, right? Because it's not any fun for him, because he's like, poof, and I'm like, help me out, I'm not a kid, right? But the little guy, even my youngest, is 14, and he's like, he's all legs, right? When you're 14, you guys remember 14, you're just like all legs, right? You can't beat him anywhere. But when they're little, it's a lot of fun, right? This is the hard thing. How do I make it challenging? And you're exactly right, user experience, how do I make that work? Maybe for you, it's about simulations or algorithms. I like to do things that help simulate the real world, right? One of the things that I love about video games is that it lets us create environments where we can test it. Right? I was part of a really cool project. As you probably know, detonating nuclear warheads is not a fantastic idea. It's generally considered destructive by rule. In fact, it is the thing we use as the most destructive example of something we can do. Right? Like, that's like the penultimate or the ultimate. Like, it's not like we set off a nuclear bomb, right? That's just the worst thing you can do. Well, what if we were able to build a computer that was so powerful it could simulate particle by particle, molecule by molecule, atom by atom, an entire nuclear detonation in such a way that we can test nuclear weapons inside silicon, inside of a computer, and never have to detonate another one on the planet Earth. Right? You know what that is? It's a video game. Don't tell anyone because they pay us a lot of money for it, okay? But it's a video game. It's a simulation. Right? It works just like a video game, but it has a very serious purpose. There are video games out there that help people deal with depression, that deal with anxiety. Right? There are learning algorithms that help people work when they're working through social anxiety disorders or things, learning disabilities. Right? They help prevent teen suicide. People that can have somewhere they can go and they can play through this game, and that game helps them to deal with problems and situations and struggles they're going through. Right? These kinds of games are extremely powerful, and it's really neat that you can make a huge difference in someone's life through something like a video game. So it's not just about blowing up other worlds and killing other people, right? Sometimes it's about understanding there's a bigger world out there. So maybe those things appeal to you. Maybe you're all about algorithms, and my family is used to hearing me say this word quite a bit, right? Because I'm always curious what you're thinking about when you're thinking about what you're thinking about. Get that? So I have a good question for you. How many of you are sock, sock, shoe, shoe people? Sock, sock, shoe, shoe? Psychos. All right, how many of you are sock, shoe people? Let the good Lord into you. No sock, shoe people?
No.
What? You don't do sock, shoe, sock, shoe?
You finish one toe before you move to the next.
But you move from one foot to the other foot. You're right there. You were right, your hands were touching that foot. Just flip the... How many of you have no idea what you do? You just like you woke up and your shoes were on, and I have no idea what happened, right? Right? All right. At least you don't do shoe sock. That would be really weird. I guess that's the weirdest, right? I'll probably start some new TikTok trend. Everyone's gonna do that now. If I started, I just want credit. That's all I'm saying. It's just tagging it. But this is funny, right? Algorithms. You think about algorithms. How do you build a peanut butter and jelly sandwich? You do first. Peanut butter always goes first. I bet you wish there was bread for it. Get a plate. Get some bread. Right? Who needs that? Bread. So old-fashioned. Right? Peanut butter first. Everyone knows you put peanut butter first. No jelly first, people? You don't need jelly? Then you can't have a peanut butter jelly sandwich. By rule. Right? There's an algorithm, right? There's a procedure for doing that. Sometimes you get it right, sometimes you don't. Here's what I'll guarantee will happen. If you drop that peanut butter or that jelly bread, it will absolutely land jelly side down or peanut butter side down. No question about it, right? Butter side down every time, right? Just that's Murphy's Law, not necessarily a law of physics, but it's Murphy's Law, right? The worst possible outcome is always what's going to happen. Maybe you want to think about how algorithms work, right? How these pieces fit together. Maybe for you, you want to build realistic environments and take people to cool places. Maybe you want to simulate weather and make something feel really real and tell a really rich story. Maybe it's about interface, right? I want to think about how I pull people into the world I've created through various and different techniques and ideas. Maybe I want to deal with augmented or virtual reality. I want to help people experience another reality, right? I want to add into what they're doing. I want to change their world that way. When you make games, it's about audio and video. It's about pictures and sounds. It's about sprites and animation. It's about decisions to make it 2D or 3D, right? How are the pieces, how they fit together? What engine am I going to use to make this game? How am I going to create it? And how am I going to distribute that game and get it out there for the world to see? A lot of cool tools available for you right now. And the neat thing is you can do it for a very, very, very low price to free, right? Incredible tools. The thing I love about games is I love to tell evocative stories, right? And when I think about people who tell stories well, I think about Pixar. It's incredible how much they can get us to care about simple things like inanimate, three-dimensional cartoon objects, right? And they're like, ah, they're my favorite, right? And I can just talk about Wally, and you're just like, Eva, you know, you just hatch right there. You can't stop yourself from doing that. Or you think of that the greatest cinematic moment, the saddest, most emotionally wrecked moment of all time happened in Up, right? I mean, that's the first 5 minutes of Up, or the most emotionally trying movie I've ever seen in my whole life, right? It's incredible. Grown people are like, it's been dusty in here. Dusty. Right? Telling stories. How do I draw you into my world and pull you in through the story? How do I help you feel what the character's feeling? How do I help you get there? Right? Very, very, very important for telling stories. So 12 quick steps. Step one, or step zero, as we say in computer world, is play games. I know, you're like, this is where you say, aw, ready? Right? Aw. I know. I can't believe Dr. Franklin, he said we had to play games, Mom. I don't want to play games, but he said I have to, so I'm gonna. Right? You gotta play games. You're never gonna be good at making games if you don't play them. But when you play them, don't just say this one's good or this one's bad. Why is this one good? What is it about that game that you really are attracted to? What is it about the game that really draws you in? Play games so you understand how to make games that don't suck. Second is don't start by coding. right? That when you want to make a game, you need to think about paper prototyping. Start on a whiteboard, make a paper prototype, make it like a card game, and see if you can make it work. Because if you can't make it work on paper, I promise you it won't get better when you put $1 million or 1,000 hours into it and make a graphical version of it. The game has to work on paper before it will ever work digitally. So think about it way before you ever get to the coding part. Second is build yourself a dev kit, right? Establish a dev kit for $0. Unity is free, Unreal is free, as long as you, both of those, when you make over $100,000 with your game, you have to give them a fee. But you should be pretty happy if that ever happens. That's gonna be the greatest fee you ever pay in your life. Like, oh darn, I have to give you $3,000 of my $100,000. Anybody make that deal? Yeah. If I give you $100,000, you give me three back? Anybody? Only a few of you. Okay, I don't know if you're teaching math in your schools, but you should probably review some math here, right? I'm pretty sure it's good stuff here, right? If you don't use Blender right now, even if you're not an artist, I highly recommend making something in Blender. So at a minimum, you'll appreciate the artists in your world that can make 3D objects for you. So learn how to do that. It's a great tool. A lot of great tools out there for making sound, for making loops, incredible assets you can do. A lot of features you can get into out there. So please establish a dev kit for $0 so you're ready to go for that. Right. The third is prototype, or step four, the fourth step, number three, is prototyping. Right? Iterative development is your friend. Build a little, play a little, try it out, test it. Build a little, try a little, test it out, repeat. Over and over, a little bit at a time, try it out. Make sure you don't get too far down a road that isn't going to work. Right? Really important concept that you think about iteratively building. Right? And make sure you get those core mechanics done first. Have you guys ever heard the phrase, swallow the big frog first? Well, now you have. Right? If you have to swallow a bunch of frogs, swallow the big one first. Then everything's better after that. Right? In other words, when you have a bunch of homework to do, do the hardest one first. Get that one out of the way, then everything else you do is going to be even easier. Right? Right? Swallow the big frog first. Hey, whatever the hardest thing is, the core mechanics of the game are the hardest part, get those down first, then work on all the other things like making it look pretty and the sound work and all those things. Use procedurally generated content, right? Let the computer build the worlds for you. Teach it how to build things and it will make them for you. So when you play a lot of video games now, especially games that use dungeon crawling kind of games, they do a lot of procedural generation, so it's a little bit different of a different world every time you play. Let the computer do the heavy lifting for you. You're a one-person team. Get out there and do that, right? And that'll help. Scaffolding and support, there's a lot of things going on out there to help you. A lot of tools available. There's tons of great tutorials. If you go on Unity3D.com, Unity's website, or you go to Unreal.com, their website, there are so many amazing videos to walk you through. Tons of expert advice. They do a lot of the blueprints inside of Unreal to make your job a lot easier. Get in there and learn from those experts. We call it standing on the shoulders of giants, right? Don't start from scratch and invent everything. See what's out there, right? Learn how to use those things. Play test it. Right? Get out there and you've got to work through your game. You've got to play it some. But I'll tell you a little secret. You cannot QA your own game. You have to have other people come in and play it for you, and you have to learn to listen to what they say. And if they tell you it's not good, it's not because they hate you or because you smell funny, it's because it's not good. You've got to learn to listen. Like, but it's my baby. I know it's hard. But you've got to learn to listen to what they're saying and then improve on that, right? Listen to that great feedback that you're getting. Improve the assets, right? Now that you have the game working, it's flowing correctly, now is when you start going through and making really great assets, making it look great, really good sound. Sound is a huge part of really great games, right? Assets are an important aspect, right? This little sprite sheet for some cool games there. 3D modeling is kind of fun. A lot of hard work to think about dynamic texturing and lighting and all those things that go into it. And then tighten up the code, right? Make it really flowing code. Make sure it really works well before you release it. Get as many people as you can to test it before you release it ever. I mean, you release it, do a soft release, and then get it out there, right? And then distribute it. Maybe you stream, maybe you use itch.io, maybe you do the Google Play Store, maybe you do it on the Apple Store, maybe you use Steam. I mean, there are a lot of distribution models out there. Most of them will charge you between 12 and 30% of the revenue of your game, and you should be the happiest person ever to pay that fee. Right? Because the exposure you're going to get by being on Steam, as an example, far exceeds whatever you could do. So a little bit more math, right? Would you rather have 100% of $1,000 or 70% of $1
million?
70% of $1 million. It's very easy, right? That's the whole idea. Right? But you're paying a fee for it. You need to recognize that they're doing a lot of work for you. They're partnering with you to do that. But they're going to charge you a fee to distribute the game. You can put it out there and shareware. You can do a little Kickstarter. There's a lot of things you can do to raise money to build your game, right? People invest. People might care. People might think this is the greatest thing ever, and all of a sudden you have $100,000 in your Kickstarter, and you can use that to build your team and make your game. The bottom line is, you know, get out there, be a part of the player community, be a part of what they're doing, give the game away for no money, and then sell ads or do in-game other stuff. There's a lot of stuff you can do there. DLCs are a great way to make money after you do your game. How do I get my name out there? How do I get people to download it, make dollar games or whatever? Just get your name out there, get this thing happening. When you come into that experience, you know, every time you have an interview, that's what you're looking for, right? The most yeses I can in any interview is that is the right recipe. So, have you ever made a game? You want to work at my game studio, have you ever done it? Yeah, I have 6 games on Steam right now, and we're doing pretty well. Wow, you're hired. Right? It's a very short conversation. Right? If you're, instead of saying, like, no, but I really want to, like, I haven't made a game, but I've played a lot of games. Oh, wow, that's super unique. You're not like any of the other people that are applying. You actually play video games? Most people never even heard of them. Right? Of course, you need to have something you've done. So the farther you've gone through this process, the better. But let me say this. You can cohort up, get 2 or 3 other people, make yourself a little indie game studio, and you can start cranking out games while in high school. And I will guarantee you something. If you put effort and energy into it and make really good games and follow these steps, you can actually pay for your entire college education with proceeds from your games. Right? But even if you only ever get to buy yourself some pizza with the proceeds, because grandma bought a copy of your game, right? The only thing better than pizza is free pizza, right? Right? So that's still not bad. Right? The experience you get is amazing. So I highly recommend you do that. One thing about being in the state of Georgia and the city of Atlanta, there are tons of amazing opportunities, tons of studios here. This isn't even updated. There are so many opportunities here that are amazing, from really small indie studios up to some pretty heavy-duty studios. So don't miss out on that, right? Don't squander that opportunity. You do not have to move to California and pay 6 times the price of living just to be there, right? It's not going to be worth it. You can work virtually really great. Come join us for a game dev weekend. We do game jams twice a year. Be a part of that. Certainly come check out Kennesaw State University. I'm happy to walk around and show you what we do. Just a couple of final thoughts. Make games, right? Join us for game jams. Come to one of our open houses. Apply to our university. Join us up. You know, come visit our website. Hang out with us, right? Learn more about our community, and I'm happy to help you. And I'm not going to try and get you to come to my university unless it's a really good fit for you. If it's a great fit, I'll tell you it is. But if it isn't, I'll help you find something that is, right? But I really, my goal for you is to find exactly what you want to do. Don't pursue money. Again, it will never make you happy. Pursue your passion. Find stuff you really love. Make sense? Right. You can make a game for free. You can get this out there, get the experience you want, buddy up, and put yourself through college. Sound good? All right. Thanks, everybody. Have an amazing day. Hey, how are you? Hey, Chris.